Father asked the son, did you ask your teacher? You seem to be proud, but did you ask your teacher that one thing, knowing which anything which is unheard of becomes heard of, anything which is unthought of becomes thought of, and anything which is unknown becomes known? So his first reaction was, there is no such knowledge. There is not possibility of such knowledge, because by knowing one thing, you only know that thing, you can't know other things. By knowing biology, you know only biology, you don't know physics. But not only that, even within biology, what you know, you can't know everything. So that means, even in that given thing, you don't know anything, what to talk of everything else. So his first reaction was, it's not possible. And it's true, right? Anything that you gain through your senses, right, and processed in the mind, through your intellect, is like that. You only know a given thing, and by knowing that, you don't know the other thing. And even that given thing, you know, you don't know fully. Yeah. But then he asks his father, first having made the statement, he then asks his father, Father, is there such knowledge? Yeah. And what the father does is, instead of talking about that knowledge, logically establishes a possibility that there can be a knowledge like that. And that is done through three different examples. So we'll see the examples. Then he says, Yatha Saumya Ekena Mrutpitena Sarvam Mrutmayam Vijnatam Syat Vacha Ramhana Vikaro Namatiyam Vritika Itsyetsam. It's a very nice example. It doesn't start with some big reality. It starts with a very simple example. And what is a simple example? The simple example is, so we are trying very hard to look for this part. The simple example is that of a pot. Yeah. Now, suppose I ask you, what is this? What would you say?
It's a clay pot.
It's a clay pot. So that means a pot. Okay, now let's go along with that. He said it's a clay pot. So that means in this statement that he made, pot is a noun, right? And clay is what? An adjective, right? This is what we say. So that means a noun can exist without adjective or not? It can, right? This is a relationship. Now, so suppose you are saying it is clay pot. So a noun can exist without an adjective. So now I'm taking away the adjective. What is the adjective in your sentence? Clay is an adjective. Pot is a noun. Let me take out the adjective clay. Show me where is pot.
There is no pot.
Do you see that?
What is there?
If I take out clay, show me where is pot.
In the sentence it is there, but not in reality.
Exactly. In the sentence, yes, you can say, okay.
No, but somebody who doesn't know, he will always say it is a pot.
Now we are talking about knowing the reality. Somebody who doesn't know the other. Now, which is the point? The point now we have come is, there is one thing, right? Which, knowing which, everything is as well known. So now, we just start with what? That this pot, right? Generally, we think that this pot has the reality. And clay is what? An adjective, which is what? Attribute of the pot. So that means, even if you take out, what is a normal relationship between adjective and a noun? Then, when the adjective goes away, noun still remains. Yeah. Now, this is not that relationship. Clay pot is not that relationship. Because if clay was merely an adjective, then when the clay goes, the noun should remain. And what is the noun? Pot should remain. But in this case, if I take out the clay, the noun will disappear. There is no two ways about it. Right? So that means this clay and pot relationship is not, normally we think it is a noun and adjective relationship. Actually, it is not noun and adjective relationship. It's another relationship. What is that other relationship? It is called Satya-Mithya relationship. What is Satya-Mithya relationship? There is one entity here which has a dependent existence, and then there is one entity here which has independent existence. So in this case, Mithya is dependent existence, Satyam is independent existence. So between the pot and clay, which is the independent existence and which is the dependent existence?
Clay is independent, pot is dependent.
Excellent. So that means clay is independent, pot is dependent. Why? Because before the pot came, clay was there. While the pot is there, clay is there. After the pot goes, clay is still there. And while the entire existence of pot entirely depends upon the clay, where is the clay in this pot?
Everywhere.
Please understand, it's not some underlying reality. It's not things are there and then down below there is clay. The whole of pot is what? Pervaded by clay. There is no part which is, it's not inside, it's not outside, it is not on the right, it is not on the left, it is not underlying, it is not overlying, it is nothing. It's all over. Now, that means even though this clay is pervaded everywhere, what if there are two things which are very, very important? Why it pervades the whole of pot? Clay intrinsically remains free from attribute of the pot. Pot has a size. Pot has this height. Pot has this width. Pot has this function. So that means that this size of pot can only hold what? This much water. You increase the size of the pot, it has a different function. It will hold more water. So that means pot has attributes. What are the attributes? The size, the shape, the width, the function. But while the clay pervading whole of pot is free from all attributes of pot. While pervading it, it is free. There is no part of pot which is not pervaded by clay. Please don't search for Satyam as something which is beneath things, which is disconnected to things. Wherever, what is a Satya-Mithya relationship? Wherever there is Mithya, exactly there is Satyam. Exactly. The pot has a dependent existence. The clay is independent of what? Being the pot.
The clay is okay. Pot is okay.
Excellent. So that means, using this analogy, what is the relationship? The pot is Mithya. By Mithya, please understand, we don't say it is unreal. This is not unreal. We don't say it is an illusion. We don't say it is false. It has an empirical reality. There is a bottom. But what happens is, whatever has empirical reality, we give it an absolute reality. That is our confusion of realities. We live in this world, whatever has empirical reality, we give it an absolute reality. So that means, if you want to make a correction, what you need to say is, neither this thought is totally unreal, nor this thought is absolutely real. It has that in-between reality, and that in-between reality is called mithya, which is dependent reality. It depends upon something else for its existence. Without that thing, this cannot exist. Now that thing upon which it exists, it pervades whole of thought, without which there is no thought, but pervading everything, it is free from attributes of what it pervades. Satya is free from the attributes of mithya. Mithya is pot. Satyam in this example is clay. Clay is free from attributes of the pot. Before the pot came, clay was there. While the pot is there, the clay is there. After the pot goes, clay is still there. And while appearing as pot, clay is free from potness. You don't need to destroy the pot to understand there is clay. You don't need to go inside the pot to discover clay. You don't need to transcend the pot to get to clay. All that is here is clay appearing as what? Appearing as what? Now, suppose if I ask you, if all that is here is clay, why do we have two names? One is called clay and the other one is pot. Why do we have two names?
Because clay can take many forms.
Excellent. So that means the clay can also take another form. This is called diya. Diya is what, well, you light a lamp here. So that means if I just use the word clay, as Kathika says, what I would not be able to what distinguish between this diya and the clay and the pot. So that means I must give different names for what
different
forms to distinguish one from other. If from one form to the other, what is the difference? Tell me. The size is different, the shape is different, the function is different, everything is different. What? That is the characteristic of the form. So that means, I can, suppose I bring five more different objects of different sizes and different shapes of clay. I will have how many different names? Five. But if I look at the substance from which each one of them gets their existence, how many substance? One. Do I need to dismantle all these different forms to discover all that is there is clay? Do I need to go inside or outside or anywhere? You don't need to do anything. Wherever there is form, which is mithya, that's exactly where satyam is. So that means then, and where, Be where there is mithya. Mithya has attributes. Satyam is free from attributes. You get this relationship? Now suppose I increase this forms from 5 to 1,000, 1 million. Does the relationship change between clay and all the different objects which are made from what? This clay. The relationship remains what? Constant. Now, suppose, look at this. Now, at present there are millions, but in the past there have been so many different clay forms and they are now all destroyed. Does it change the reality that clay is the truth of that? It doesn't change. Even if I don't know all the different forms that existed, I may not be able to what? Give all the names of all the different objects that existed in the past. I may not be able to name all the different forms that will come in the future. Nowadays, the artists are Kanika, they are so creative, they can create forms which were never known to you. From this very what you can create new forms. So that means there were many clay forms in the past which don't exist now. There are many clay forms in the present known to me and unknown to me. And then can exist many clay forms in the future which are yet to come, which are not even discovered yet. This is what we call modern art. But if I know the clay, and if I know that all of them are modification of clay, and while the forms are modifications, clay doesn't undergo any change as such, then by knowing this clay, the entire clay world is known to me. Do you understand that? Because it's a very special relationship. What is the relationship? It is satya mithya between the form and its content. The forms can never be known in detail. Forms you can't know in detail. If I ask you to write all the different forms that the clay had from the time that what the world started, will you be able to name them? If I ask you, list all the forms that the clay has taken now, right now in this world, you will not be able to read it. If I ask you, tell me all the possibilities of the forms that the clay will take in the future, can you enlist them? You can't. So that means the details you may not know and you will never know. But without knowing the details, what you can know the truth. And what is that?
Clay.
Clay was there before any form existed in the past, before any clay form existed in the present, and any form that it exists in the future. While the form exists with its unique shape, with its unique size and its unique function, clay will remain free from what? That size, that function and that those dimensions. And after the form disintegrates, what will remain is what? So that means by knowing one clay, you know what the entire clay world without knowing what the details. Details you don't know. But you can know the entire clay world because there is no second, there is only one thing. And what is that? Clay. Unchanging clay. So that means that it is as though it has taken what forms. As though. Appearance is not just, as though does not mean that it is illusion. That's not. It means that it appears in that given form for that given point in time. Empirically true. So therefore, now, so the entire clay world is known, but different, but without knowing specific forms, the entire clay world is known by knowing what? The relationship between clay and everything else, every form. Forms do not do anything to the substance. That is the relationship. Forms cannot change the content. The content is independent of being the form. But the form cannot exist without its content. That is what we call satya mithya relationship. Now, this particular thing, it's very important that once you know the clay, the entire clay world is known. Without knowing the specifics. Now, what here, the second example is given. What is the second example? So it's not only this clay and pot relationship. He gives another example, and that is what example of a goat. Similar, he gives three examples. What is the second example? Yatha Saumya Ekena Loham Manina Sarvam Lohamayam Vignatam Syat Vacha Rambhanam Vikaro Namadeyam Loham Ekena Sat. So here, he gives an example of the goal. Okay? So that means, what is this goal? Suppose you make from one lump of gold, different ornaments. One is a ring, one is a necklace, one is an earring, one is a bangle. So that means, how many, if your attention is on the forms, how many forms are there? Many, multiple forms, right? But if your attention is on the content, which is the gold, how many things are there? So that means many forms but one content. Satya Mithya relationship. If you take out gold from the necklace, from the ring, from the earring, from the bangle, what will remain as bangle? Nothing. So this is what he says, Vikaraha. What is Vikaraha? The form is Namadeya. What is Namadeya? It is a given name that you need to give. Why do you need to give? As Kanika said, you do need to distinguish what necklace from ring. And you do need to distinguish ring from what bangle. Why? Because you can't put a ring on your neck and you can't put bangle also on your finger. So that means there are different forms. Nobody is denying that there are different forms. We are not trying to collapse different forms. We are not trying to go beyond forms. We are not trying to find underlying truth with forms. What we are seeing is there is one reality which is pervading each form.
Loham means what is it?
Loham is gold. That is the second one is gold and the third one is iron. Three
examples.
So Loham actually is a metal. But here it is taken as gold and the third example is given as iron. So all three examples are given. Here actually Loham means metal, but here in the example, it is taken as wood, precious metal, and the third example is that of iron. Okay, so that means what? So that means that there is one thing without undergoing any change, as though becomes what many. So this particular thing of one becoming, one taking on the form without intrinsically undergoing any change. The goal does not undergo any intrinsic change to become all of this. This particular phenomena in Sanskrit is called vivarta upadana karana. Upadana karana means what? Material cause. But that material cause which becomes the effect without undergoing any intrinsic change. Do you see? There are two types of material causes. One is what we call vivarta upadana karana, and the other one is what we call parinami upadana karana. What does it mean? It means, suppose I make from the milk curd, right? So what is the material cause of the curd? Milk, right? Without milk you can't make curd. But the effect which is curd is what is the milk has undergone a change to become curd. So that means in the curd, the original milk is what? Modified. That is what we call parinami upadana karana. But there is something which is what we call vivarta upadana karana. Without undergoing any change, it what takes on this form. So that means the clay does not, see in the curd you don't find original milk, it has undergone modification. But in the ornament, do you find the original gold or not? Yes. The original gold and its qualities and it remains intact. It takes on that shape without undergoing any what particular real modification. This is what we call vivarta upadana karana. So now the third example is given. And what is that? The iron. What is the iron example? Here he says, yatha saumya ekena naha ni krutanena sarvam kashna yasam vignatam syat vacha rakpanam vikaram namadeyam krushnayam itneva satyam somya saha adesha bhavati. This is interesting because before, what was the approach? You show what? The satyam. You say, okay, there is this mrittika. Mrittika is what? The clay is the truth, and pot, which is what a modification of that clay, is nitya. Right? In the case of loham, it was exactly the same. That the gold is here, and the gold can take many different sizes and shapes, and can have many different functions, but itself remains only gold. The coming into taking that form has not changed gold at all. It was gold before, it is gold while the ornament is there, after the ornament goes, it still remains gold. And that gold pervades whole of the ornament. Not inside, outside, below, above, nothing. Whole of the ornament. Now, here, the third example is given in an interesting way. It doesn't start with the substance, it starts with the form. Nakalukandena is what? That nail cutter. So that means, now suppose you look at a nail cutter, and now what happens is you are trained not to give more reality to the form but to the substance of which the form is made. What will you do by looking, where is, what are you looking at? You are looking at nail cutter, and what do you conclude? It is iron. Because this nail cutter, where, what is it made up of?
Iron.
So that means, now suppose you go out there and you see a huge iron gate. Then what happens? Do you take them as different?
Both are
iron. So that means your buddhi is trained to see what the reality is differently. Where normally for us, forms seem more real. That is our orientation. When forms seem more real to us, then what happens is the content of the form is missed out totally. But when you begin to see the content, then what happens? You can appreciate different forms, but you don't lose sight of the fact that what? Even if the form is very different, you don't lose sight of the fact that there is what? It enjoys the same reality. Where is a nail cutter? So different, small little thing. Iron gate, so big in size. But when you, it is a shift of vision. Nothing physically changes. Physically, the nail cutter remains a nail cutter, and iron gate remains iron gate. You don't need to transcend it, you don't need to manipulate it, you don't need to do anything. You don't need to demolish it. What has shifted is what? Your vision. The differences, the apparent differences, don't fool you. You don't try to manipulate the differences to see what some final truth behind. So that means there is a shift. It's, this is what we call a paradigm shift. Paradigm shift where you can easily, you don't try to what make the iron gate do the function of a nail cutter, because ultimately everything is iron. You don't do that. Otherwise, what can happen is Vedanta can lead to so much confusion of realities. When you try to manipulate things, the reality is what is there. It doesn't require any manipulation on your part. You don't need to do anything to the gold. Gold is there in spite of different size and shape. You don't need to change the size and shape, demolish everything to understand that all that is here is gold. This orientation, this is so important that even to understand the final reality, we want things to be different. That things to be different means it's a catch. The forms don't do anything to substance regardless of what knowledge. So therefore, these are what we call the three examples that are given. What are these examples given? These are demonstrations. It is actually not even a demonstration. It is creating a plausibility. What is a plausibility? How? By knowing one thing, what everything can be. Do you see? This is what, by knowing clay, the entire clay world can be known. The entire clay world of past, present and future. Things, the clay world which is known, the forms which are known to be and unknown to be. It includes everything. There is one thing which is knowing which you don't need to know the details. If your knowing of details was required in order to, for you to know the clay, then what? Human mind cannot know all the different forms. It's not given the capacity to know all the different forms. But human mind is given the capacity to know the clay, knowing which, what all the clay forms are known. Known to me, unknown to me, past, future. One thing doesn't change. What doesn't change? It is all nothing but clay. And to the clay, there is no real addition, there is no real subtraction. That is what we can understand. Form cannot doesn't matter. It doesn't do anything. Forms change. They are going to change. Nobody can keep the forms constant. So that means your attempt is not to keep anything constant. Your attempt is to see that while forms are changing, the content remains. So therefore, this is what we call a plausibility. Plausibility means it is possible. What? That knowing one thing, what? Everything can be known. When there is which relationship? Not in every relationship. When there is which relationship? Satya-vidya relationship. In that given relationship, what? By knowing the satya, mithya world is what? As well. Not in any, you can't just extrapolate and put in any relationship. It's not like that. Specific to satya-mithya relationship, that is the case. Now, suppose, okay, you can say, okay, I understand that in order to know the clay world, in order to know the entire clay world, all I need to do is to what? Not know all the, without knowing all the forms, I can only know the clay, and that's it. But how does it apply to the whole universe? That's a different ball game altogether. By knowing clay, I only know what? The entire clay world. By knowing gold, I know only what? Entire gold world. By knowing the iron, I know only the iron world. But how do you use this logic to then say, by knowing one thing, everything in the universe will be known? These examples, please understand, they don't demonstrate, they only create what? Plausibility. Plausibility, that it is possible. And why is it possible? Because in that relationship it is possible. Which relationship it is possible? Satya-mithya relationship it is possible. Now, you still need to know how does it, this logic apply to what? The whole universe. So that is said in the next verse. Now, one thing. Before we go to the next, here it says, now, this is exactly what Shweta Ketu was so smart. He's saying, okay, you're showing me that knowing one thing, you can know what the things which are made up of that. But you still haven't shown me what, how does it apply to the whole universe? How in the whole universe there is one thing, knowing which, what everything is as well. So says that if it is interesting, that little line, he said that if my teacher knew it, here he says, na vai guna bhagavantaha tat etat vedishuhu yat etat avedishyan katham me na avakshan iti bhagwan me tat braviti iti tatha somya iti avumacha. This is nice because what he says is that, you know, with reference to the whole universe, suppose my previous teacher, he knew it, he knew that there was one thing, which is the truth of everything, then he would have certainly told me. Why would he have certainly told me? Because I'm smart. If my teacher knew it, he would have definitely told me, because I'm capable of learning. This is a very nice attribute, a kind of a nice quality of a person who can say, right now I don't know it, but what, I am capable of knowing it. This is a nice, good student. So that means it may take time, who knows. But the thing is, he says to his father, if my teacher had known this knowledge, he would have taught me. Why? Because I am capable of understanding it.
Self-esteem.
Then he says, I don't know whether he knew it or not, but at least now you tell me. You seem to know it, you tell me. So that means, in order for it to be right for the whole universe, what should be the relationship between one thing and everything else? Tell me. Satyamitya. Only then it is possible. Otherwise it is not possible. So that means, one has to be an independent reality. Everything else has to be what? A dependent reality. That which is the satyam, then what? Pervades everything. But pervading everything, it is free from everything. And that satyam has not really undergone any change to become metal. Like the clay has not undergone any change to become the entire bottle. So that means this sat that we are talking about is not some man feeling sad, so the sat is a very, this is a sat of that magnitude. No mithya can touch. Nothing that happens in Mithya can touch Satya. So that means this is this Satya. So now, how does it apply to the whole thing? So this is where the Tandya. What is that? It refers to the whole universe now. Sadeva Somya Idam Agra Asi Ekam Eva Atatriya. Tat ekam ahuhu asateva idam agra asi ekam evam advitiyam tasmat asataha sat jayata. This is very interesting. Now, he makes the statement that suppose what the whole, in case of the whole universe, right, this particular statement will be true if before everything came, there was what? One thing. From which everything came. And everything that is here is vikara. What? A modification. Which has taken what? Different forms. But the content remains sat. So that means that sat vastu. So that means now, what that sat in Sanskrit is what we call in English existence. Sat is existence. Every existence that we know of exists within what? Time and space. Right? Any existence. Anything that I say exists, exists within what?
Time
and space. There is nothing that I see with my eyes which does not exist within time and space. So what Upanishads are saying is, there is one existence which is not like existence of things. There is one existence from which came what? All the different forms. Now, that existence, if it was there before all the forms came, then it would become what? A belief. How do you know? Nobody was there then. But if, suppose, the same existence is here and now, while the forms appear, then it becomes what? Not a belief. Like, if you were told, one, before the ornament came, there was gold. Okay. But while the ornament is there, there is still gold. So that means, if there was this existence which was there before the forms came into being, it will be a belief. But while the forms are there, there is this existence, then it is what? Not a belief. Where is this existence? Which, from which comes all the forms, but itself is what? Not any form. So that means, just as when you begin to look at bangle, what you find is gold. Similarly, look at any given form that exists right now. That's all you have to do. You take any given form, because that sat which was there before the form came into being is also now there while the form is existing. That existence will also remain after the form goes. So, now, let's look at the form. Any form that I look at right now, it seems like what? That a very tangible form. So that means, let's take the same clay, right? Now, suppose up to now we used this satya mithya relationship to show that the pot was mithya and for the time being clay was satyam, that which independently exists. Now, you need to question a little bit more and you have to say, hey, this clay itself has what? Dependent existence. What does the clay depend upon?
Atoms.
Yeah. Ultimately, it depends upon atoms. The atoms themselves depend upon
particles.
And the particles themselves depend upon what?
Quarks.
Quarks. And that means it can keep going down and down and down. So that means there is what? Mithya within mithya within mithya within mithya within mithya. One form, but it is what? It is coming together of how many different forms. So that means now the quarks themselves, where did they come from? So this is where there is a limitation of what we call the data that you can receive from what? From your eyes and the inference. So this is why you ask any quantum physicist, they said, they can't know. Because why? They are expecting some form to be the truth of that form. And they themselves realize that what a quantum physicist will tell you, that after a point, there is no direct perception. They don't see anything. That's why it is all just mathematics, not concepts, only formulas. There is no corresponding tangible object. So that means that these forms are forms within forms within forms within forms within forms within forms. But there is one thing which remains constant. What is that constant? Particle is. Is constant. Particle, the form, is what combined together to become what? Atoms. Atom is. Then the atoms come together and then what?
Clay.
Clay is. So that means there are forms which are what? At each level there is assemblage. And as a result of assemblage, there is a new characteristic which is acquired. So the forms are what? Getting increased in complexity. There is one thing which remains what? Constant. And what is this? Is. Existence, 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 existence. Sat. Forms become complex. Just as the ring begins, as you intervene a little more, you can make two strings, you can make three strings, but the gold remains gold. Existence remains exactly as it is. Every little tiny thing which comes from existence combines to produce what? Different forms. The existence sat remains. So that means before any form came, there is existence. While the form is there, the tiniest form, the existence is still there. That tiniest form gets assembled with another form to create further complex form. The existence is what? Still there. There is one existence which is not existence of a given form, it is the existence from which all the different forms come. The forms undergo change. With each level of assemblage, it acquires new characteristic. But then one existence remains constant, it doesn't undergo change. So what happens is, we only see forms, and because we only see forms, what happens is, we give truth to the form. What we miss out on is what? That existence. This existence is there before the form comes. Generally, what is our understanding? The form exists, so the existence we think is what? A limited existence. Form has a limited existence. There is one existence upon which all the forms exist. Itself is not limited to forms. Without which the forms cannot exist. Without which the forms cannot assemble to create new forms. It is something which is constantly there. So that means there is this one existence, Sat. Now, that was there before what happened? The whole universe came into being. Now, what suppose I say, oh, I don't believe it. Why should I believe that there was this existence? Maybe before the creation came, there was nothing. Why should I think that there was this existence? So this is what a person who is listening to this knowledge will which is coming from the Upanishad can have a contention. What is the contention? It is born of your intellect, right? You can say, I don't accept that there was existence. There was nothing. So this is what this person says. Tat etat ahuhu asateva idam agna asi. Suppose, why can't I think that everything came and before everything came there was nothing? Exactly. So this is what it says. If you have a different postulate, if you postulate differently, and that is what before everything came there was nothing, then logically it will fall apart. How will it fall apart logically? Because you can't make a statement that something came from nothing. It's not possible. Show me one example in this world where something came from nothing. God, pot came from clay. Gold, and the chain came from gold. So that means you can't, there is a logic. What is the logic? You can't have effect without the cause. Not possible. Show me one example of having an effect without cause. You have no argument to take on that position. Because if you take that other position, you have to be able to demonstrate that something came from. So that means everything that exists has to come from something. So that means now there is this existence which was there before coming into manifestation of all the different forms. Now what you need to understand is, your next question is, how did this existence, God, create such a varied world? The existence from which came what? Time, space,
objects.
All the different objects
and the laws.
And the laws which govern the objects. How? How is it possible from this existence comes everything? So, this is what this next part that we will see in the evening. The answering of the question, how this thing, one existence became everything. Now, what you need to know is, what Vedanta says, you have to understand, the strength of Vedanta. It's strength, it's not really a strength of Vedanta. In the sense that you can't assess the validity of Vedanta through this. What you want to know is, everything that Vedanta says is something which converges with what? The latest discovery of science. There is nothing which goes against logic. Why? Because thousands of years ago, the rishis said the world is mythical. They used only simple example of what potted clay. Now quantum physics, with its advanced discoveries, shows the whole world is what? Mithya. Mithya means what? It's forms within forms within forms within forms. Nothing is as real as it seems. So mithya form of the world is now you can use what before you don't need quantum physics. You can do it by just a simple pot and clay example. That's why you didn't need quantum physics. But now you can use quantum physics to further substantiate what Vedanta is saying. You don't need to be afraid of anything. You can use all the knowledge in the world. It embellishes Vedanta. It is not a threat. Now, there is a second thing which is, what the second thing is, that the existence, the existence is something. Right now, I can demonstrate that the existence can, what different permutations and combinations can create different forms. There is one thing which remains constant. Is. So that means there is a modification, and while the modification is there, there is one thing which is constant. What we normally can see with our eyes is what? Only the forms. Because we see only the forms, what we miss out on is what? That one constant presence. And that constant presence, Upanishads make you see. And where will you find that constant presence? It will show you it is right where you are. That don't see. You don't need to search for that presence somewhere else. That presence which is invariable in every form is with you right now. So there is this what? Unfolding of this reality. Uses logic. Everything cannot come from nothing. You have no logic to contradict that. Show me one example where something comes from nothing. So that means world is mithya. It has to come from something. That something is not an object. That something which is constant is, according to Vedanta, your true nature.
Did the quantum physics agree?
Sorry?
Did the quantum physics, where the talk, agree to this model?
So, in fact, they are themselves talking a lot and they wanted to know more. See, they are very, you may think that, as we were talking, a common man thinks that scientists know a lot. Right? And of course, with reference to us, they do know a lot. Sure. Because why do they know a lot? Because they have engaged deeply into things. Right? But the quantum physicist, if that person is a real thinker, they also know much more than what we know, what they don't know. If he's really honest. So that means there is this whole thing of curiosity. So that means you may think that the scientist himself is very curious. So this is where I was saying, who is a person who is eligible for this knowledge? The person with what? Curious mind. So at the end he says, please give me a lot of books, I want to know more about them. Not dismissive. Dismissive means without engaging. Your buddhi is lazy, doesn't want to engage. Without looking into things, you just want to negate it. That is again another self-defense mechanism to keep the status quo. You don't want to move forward. So that means, at least listen to what Upanishads say. The Upanishads will show you something that you can never on your own figure out. And in that reality, that existence is your true nature. What more do you want? That existence which was there before time came, before space came, before what? Every object within time and space. The objects undergo change. Objects come and go. That existence which is your true nature doesn't change, without which no forms can come. Within the world, all the modifications exist, all the forms go back into that existence. That existence is something which never takes on the attribute of forms. that existence, that promise that you are, it shows you through this teacher. From where to where? You think you are this little small struggling person. And Vedanta shows you, you are that existence which was there before the universe came. While the universe is there, after the universe and all the forms within the universe comes and goes. And it, that existence exists in and through all the forms, not affected by anything that happens in the form. That is your true nature. Where is its connection to your little one desire? No connection. You have to see it clearly. No connection. Before the universe came, it was there. While the universe is there, it is there. After the universe and every form within the universe is changing, it goes and it is there. That is your true nature. There is one thing in changing you, there is one non-changing thing. That non-changing is your true nature. Right now. So we will see how there's a whole big teaching which makes you see that.
Om Purnamidam Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate Om Shanti 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 Om Shri